does wonderful things. It bakes you breakfast, defogs your windows.
All sorts of stuff.
Oh, it does windows? Then I'm cool with that. I can use the windows. I can use the windows stuff.
And I can go ahead and give an update on Viewer Managed Marketplace, because yesterday afternoon, that viewer went into RC. So it is one of the viewers that is available for you all to try out, and we are hoping to get it pushed through the paces quickly. So if you see any problems, definitely let us know. And so they will, hopefully, we'll be able to get that out and start getting people migrated.
Oh, Brooke, do you know if they're going to make some of the 3 months premium thing retroactive for those of us who are premium already?
We'll just add 3 free months to your existing memberships. So it'll extend it for 3 months.
Okay, cool, because I'm already beta testing and I'm a premium member.
Yes, you'll get, for those who did the volunteer for the migration, they will, we're almost done. We have one more person that we're finishing doing migration, and then we'll award those who participated.
Yeah, I still need to finish mine, so that may be me that needs to finish the migration.
Well, so the premium memberships are were for people who we actually put through our automated migration process. So, Animorph, did we work with you on that? I'm like trying to remember. So we'll follow up on that and look you up. I've got some notes on that. So are there any other questions about Viewer Managed Marketplace while I'm here, or questions for Alexa about the new viewer that's gone out?
My big question is, when's it going, VMM going live? It's the big thing for me.
Yeah, as soon as the viewer gets pushed to the release viewer.
Yeah.
And that will be hopefully as fast as possible, but obviously, you know, the viewer process does tend to take a month or so.
Yeah, the big thing for us is the availability of the finished code and getting it in for our next release. That's our biggest concern at the moment.
Yeah.
Well, amongst other things, I was sent here to annoy Oz about.
Nice.
Well, somebody's got to do it, you know.
I'm sure he appreciates it very much.
Well, yeah. Well, you know, I did give him the option. He could just, you know, get me banned from Second Life for life, and no more problem. I won't bug him anymore, right?
It's amazing how many of you ask to be banned on a regular basis.
Well, I've been trying to get fired for 5 years now.
Yeah, yeah, Jessica it says work. It's not happening.
Sorry about the delay with Oz. I'm not sure if he is having connection problems. Let me try pinging him again.
Yeah, I know. I can't leave until Jess does.
Ed, you did see the tag I was wearing over my head when you came in, didn't you?
No, I don't have name tags on. I very seldom have name tags on.
Ah, okay. Yeah, I kind of very seldom do too, but oh well.
Yeah, that's one of the three things that I'm gonna. Sadly, Izzy's not here either. So I think Alexa has to share with all of us if she's gonna snack on Mike.
Oh God, I'm sorry.
Well. Only be sorry if you didn't bring enough to share with everybody.
Come up to Seattle, I'll feed y'all.
And the next time I'm on my way to Portland, I'll stop by.
Sorry, that's the joys of wiping out all your settings so your middle mouse button starts your talk, your speak again.
Don't feel
and
bad.
Here he is, to save me.
Hi, Oz.
Yay. Well, I'll have to stop and visit you when I'm out there, Tara. Hi, Oz.
Hi, everybody. I'm sorry I'm late. I had a little problem that had to be dealt with here at home. So, I'm guessing Brooke has already told you everything you needed to know about Viewer Managed Marketplace.
Yeah, and Alexa and I did fall down on the job for coming up with jokes. We did our best. Ed mostly helped us out there by talking about how he likes to make your life difficult. So,
good.
Yeah. I've been sent to annoy you today.
All right. Yeah.
Anyway,
I got warned about that actually.
I'm gonna jump off since I gave the update and you're here, Oz. And so thanks everybody, and feel free to ping me or Oz with questions.
Okie dokie, Brooke. Thank you.
Okay, so let's see. Have we... I should do the rundown of viewers. We now have 4 release candidates out. The experienced viewer, the more attachments viewer, the viewer managed marketplace viewer, of course, which you just heard about, and a maintenance viewer that just went out minutes ago. That's just a collection of bug fixes. Experiences and viewer managed marketplace will probably be the leading contenders for promotion next. I don't expect there to be a promotion next week. Because we did a couple close together and we don't like to keep doing that. Expect next week to be a week off, and then it will probably be one of those two after that. So far, everything, fingers crossed, is doing very well in RC. So we're going to have a relatively unconstrained choice here. And then project viewers, we have, we will hopefully get an update to the Rift viewer at some point soon. I expect a voice project viewer next week with fixes from Vivox. It is probably true that we will have a project viewer based on the HTTP, the LL Core HTTP changes. That one will probably remain a project viewer for a while. It'll be a couple of rounds of updates, I'm sure. But we're going to put it out where people can start playing with it. Let people find whatever problems we've introduced with that. There may be an update, a viewer with our revamped notifications interface. And there might even, in the next couple of weeks, before our next get-together, be a project viewer for the CEF effort. That's coming together. So lots going on. Much, much stuff. Snowstorm, we've got two active streams there. One is the various build cleanups, which include a lot of contributions from you folks, and that's in very good shape, except it's not finished, but has been kind of on hold because we had to take the person who was doing most of the work on that and put them on a different firefight. Hopefully we'll be able to wake that back up again very, very soon. And the other one, the one that's got Jonathan's graphics preferences changes and the avatar rendering changes, is still waiting for me to fix what I broke in avatar rendering. So if any of you feel like helping out with debugging that, I would really be grateful, because I messed it up somehow. And avatars that are supposed to be, I'll get you the repo URL. It is, where did I put it?
Yeah, I think Orly posted the link for you, Oz.
Yeah, that's the right one. I just was double checking because I've moved that around a couple of times. And that is the correct one. So the bug is that avatars that should be displayed as, in Whirly's charming terminology, as jelly babies, right, the solid color things, are instead invisible, except that some of their attachments render. I think the mesh ones, but and that's not right. So the behavior I was shooting for is that avatars with incomplete data render as gray the way they do now, and that's still true, although that's very, very brief. And avatars that are expressly muted, that you have selected and said mute this, just don't show. And ones that are above the render complexity that you have set are render as the colored outlines. And then imposters, other sorts of imposters, ones that are just too far away from you to be, or have too many, they're not the end closest avatars, you know, they get the progressively more simple rendering. And I think all of that is working except for the colored outline avatars. So I think that's the current status of that. I just merged that up to the latest tree. Have I pushed that? No, I haven't pushed that, so I will do that. I have something to check in before I do, but I'll do that. So that will, as soon as we're done with this meeting, I'll push that. And anybody who wants to look at it, I'd really love some help because I just haven't had enough time to sit down. And I'm not very good at the rendering problems myself, so somehow I busted it. That would be great to get some some help with that. So anyway, we've got a lot going on. And I understand that there's a discussion to be had about the damage changes, which let me preface this discussion with, I'm happy to have the discussion and listen intently. I have read the issues that have been posted on it. But we're mostly going to have to wait until Grumpity is back, in another week and a half, 2 weeks, before we're going to end up making any decisions about it. So consider the topic open, but the topic isn't going to get closed, and I'm not going to make any judgments until I've had a chance to talk to Grumpity.
So, okay. Well, for everybody else's information, there's been some changes with the way damage is turned on, and there's a Jira on it. I'm pretty sure Whirly will have a link for me here shortly. And frankly, we're not very happy about it, because there are cases where you want to be able to turn damage on a parcel, and with the changes made, that's rather difficult, or can be rather difficult now.
I think the intent was that it was impossible. I believe from what I've read that it's that sometimes it looks as though that's what happened, and in fact, it isn't really true. So,
well, in order to turn damage on, you have to go to the estate manager or owner, and then get them to turn. Yeah, it's a right royal pain in the ass, to be blunt. Or use an older viewer.
Right, but what I meant to say is that we've made. I don't believe there have been any server side changes to any of this at this point. The changes are all viewer side, and they don't seem to. What the viewer thinks ought to be true doesn't seem to always be true. So, regardless of what set of behaviors we ultimately decide we want to be the way this works, about which I profess to have no opinion. We're going to have work to do either on the viewer or on the server or both to get everything harmonized. I don't even know what the motivation for the change was, actually. I mean, it had been released before I noticed that it was happening. So,
yeah, the big thing for me personally is I've always lived on damage-enabled land in Second Life. And quite frankly, it's the easiest way to not get griefed on a private region is have damage on, because they don't like to keep coming back if they keep dying all the time.
Oh. Okay.
It may sound a little bloodthirsty, but it is a quick and easy way to deal with griefers.
Really? Never really thought of it that way.
4 years on a private region, Oz, and we got griefed twice.
Now you've said that on something that's going to be posted on a recording, you're in for it.
Well, that's okay. We're not in that region anymore.
Oh, okay.
Okay. But seriously, you know, and it was a public region. We were teaching our classes there. We had Halloween hunts going on that region, and it's a great deterrent. It truly is.
Oh. Well, I hadn't really thought about it from that perspective. That's interesting.
At any rate, I was informed that I'm supposed to vent our displeasure.
Okay. Well, it will certainly be on the things to be discussed list prominently when Grumpity gets back. But it isn't something I'm going to try to disentangle without her.
Okay, so let us know when Grumpity's back, and we'll come with our pitchforks and torches and the whole outfit.
Right, right. Well, she should be all rested and ready for that when she gets back, I guess. So, Let me just look when next time is so that I know. 2 weeks from now is a holiday. So I have it marked on my calendar as the next one is July 17th. But maybe I ought to move that to the 10th.
Well, you let us know and we'll be here.
Does anybody have a preference? Because I could do it either way. I could either do the next one on, if we're going to stick to Fridays, I could either do the next one on the 10th, which would be 3 weeks from today. And then 2 weeks after that would be, yeah, that's what I should do. I don't know. I seem to have left a week empty. All right. I will do it that way.
So we're going to do the 10th and then again on the 24th.
It won't be the 24th because I'll be on vacation.
Oh, okay.
So it'll be the 10th and then the 31st.
Okay.
I will be in Las Vegas.
Oh, losing all your money?
Hopefully not. Yeah. let's see. So we will make sure that there's time on the agenda on the 10th, and Grumpy will have been back for a little while then, so she'll be able to be up to speed about why we were doing it and have formulated her position about what else we should do, whether it's reverting some of those changes or doing something different. And we'll make sure we've got plenty of time blocked off for that then. We're going to try to make, my intent is that we will try to make the next three viewer releases be in some order, experiences, viewer managed marketplace, and the attachments viewer. That would be my guess, but I am not prepared to guess what order those will have. And I know that that makes it less helpful, but sorry. After all, if I gave you a guess and you acted on it and then I turned out to be wrong, it would be worse. So, we got any other topics? Because I'm out.
Oh, yeah. I was sent here to bother you. But I'll let everybody else have a chance first.
All right. Oh, cool. Retina display. That's fun. Good. I'll have a look at that.
Oz, has there been any work done on the interest listing? Because we're still having issues with things not rendering, or taking a long time to render.
We have not touched the interest list deliberately at all.
Deliberately?
Well,
does that mean
you never know when something's going to have a side effect? I don't claim that nothing we have done has had an effect. It is a bit of a touchy area. So we've been kind of hoping we could leave it alone for a little while. I'm interested in hearing about reproducible ways in which it misbehaves. But understand that in order to do that, we also have to isolate from that any problems with doing the actual texture and mesh data fetching, right? So if, or for that matter, lost UDP messages. It's not consistent. And I mean, it's very, very difficult for us to justify making changes to it if we can't see and measure whether or not there was a particular problem and we've fixed it. There is somebody, I noticed this morning that somebody picked up the issue where you mess up the interest list if you change your group tag while things are still loading. Whether or not they'll succeed in figuring out why it's a problem and fixing it remains to be seen. But there is somebody working on that even as we speak.
Yeah, group tags are weird things.
Yeah, I've been studying what the chain of causality on those is. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, I've been having some issues with teleporting into laggy regions, and things like my shoes are turning invisible.
They used to be magic. They're not so magic anymore. They're more problematic now than they were. They're almost as problematic now as they were magic before.
Right. Well, I would like it. I would like to be able to say that we'll make them really pedestrian and predictable someday.
Well, they were. You could refresh your view simply by changing your group tag.
Right.
It's very predictable.
The various attachment bugs, that's another one that I'll want people to factor out as much as possible, factor out of any discussion of the interest list by doing the testing using the more attachments viewer. Its tag name is Big Bird. It's on the alternate viewers page as the Big Bird viewer, I think. And that has our primary collection of fixes for attachments. There are still some issues with that that maybe need some server-side tweaking, but we haven't had a chance to get to that. It's certainly much, much better than any, thank you, Whirly, than any previous viewer. You're going to have to direct that to Veer, because he's the one who came up with the name. That was his effort.
Okay, is that what the Crystal Clear app downloader viewer is? Is the attachments viewer?
I don't know. It's the one that's linked here in chat. It just got an update yesterday.
June 16th, 2015. It's like Tuesday.
Okay. Well, that's when it was built. That's not when it was, anyway. It's 302.640. That's the build number. Yeah, layer limits is in release. Because that has a there were a lot of race conditions in how the interactions between changes to your inventory, your viewer's local beliefs about what you did and did not have attached, and the server's beliefs about what you did and did not have attached. And anytime you have three-cornered protocols like that, it's the getting everybody to have a consistent view of the universe is kind of hard. And we've mostly sorted that out. We think. So that's probably the one to use if you're trying to figure out whether or not what you've got is an attachments problem or an interest list problem. Interest list mostly has to do with the things that are around you, not the things that are attached to you. Things that are attached to you, you find out about by changes, by messages that change your appearance. The interest list is concerned with updating you about where everything else, what other things are around you and what characteristics they have.
So just out of curiosity, a question for you on that. There's a case where when people sit down, they disappear. When they sit on an object, they wind up at 000 for a certain amount of time. Would that be related to the interest list, or would that be something else?
It's a kind of a hybrid, I think. So the when you sit on something, you basically become part of that something. You become an attachment to that something. And so if you don't have a correct current view of where the something is, then you end up at 000, right? So if I see an object and sit on it, but you haven't got a position for that object, then you'll see me translate it to 000 just because my position is uninitialized, basically. My understanding is that that's a case of your viewer and my viewer not being in sync with respect to where the object I'm sitting on is. And usually the problem is that you haven't got a position for that object.
And yeah, Annie, that's sort of what happens. They wind up sitting down at 000. If you cam on them, that's what you see.
Right. That's what that is that for whatever reason, you haven't gotten an update for the object that they sat on, so you don't have a position for it.
Yeah, we had an interesting case at our support meeting today where G came in and couldn't see any of the chairs sitting around our table. Until he right-clicked on one. Then the chair showed. That's interestless, that one. But the same sort of thing happens.
I think so, right.
Actually, I found a workaround for curving, folks.
The interest listing thing I'm thinking is like when I teleport out of a sim and then back into a sim, like the media boards that are surrounding us not being here as well as the stadium that most of us are here in not rendering. That to me seems like interest listing.
Could be. Yeah. Should be, because if you've been here and allowed everything to res, then you should have all the data about what it looks like, its shape and its textures, that should all be in your cache.
Yeah, because I can right-click it and it will render. And it's still taking a considerable length of time to do that. And that's being reproducible by teleporting out and then back in.
Yeah, see, I never have that problem. I don't.
That's the big problem with half the problems we see, Oz, is, you know, half the people can reproduce it and half of them can't.
Right. Right.
All right, so I'm going to jump in here in a moment of silence.
Go ahead.
Group. Both of these have to deal... Both of these issues that I want to bring up have to do with groups. The one is, you're going to tell me there's nothing been done so far, but that's okay. I wanted to bring up the group member list loading again.
Right. What about it?
I mean,
Just the
just
fact
wondering that you did. Well, the fact that it's just not in our opinion, not right that list doesn't load. It makes it far more difficult for some people. And you'd already said you were going to look into stuff, but I'm obligated to bring it up because I.
I'm totally in agreement that it's suboptimal that those groups don't load. The current state of affairs is purely we believe, an interim solution for that keeps other worse problems from being true until we can do something better. When we started working on those worst problems, and I got an explanation of how group membership loading worked, I was basically horrified and actually gave serious consideration to just saying nobody can load any groups. Obviously, we didn't go that way. Cooler heads prevailed. But it's a pretty awful. It's a pretty awful cascade of events, and we'll fix it. But we're going to have to spend a little design time and really come up with a better solution. And then we'll have a new API for dealing with groups.
Okay.
Well, I don't want to speak ill of my predecessors here, and I certainly don't want anything to be interpreted that way. But an awful lot of any large system is that, you know, the way something works accretes, you know, it's layers, and it's this one ended up with a couple too many layers and a couple too many things. And I don't think anyone in the early days of Second Life who was inventing the concept of groups ever would have thought that we would have groups anything even remotely like as large as they actually have gotten. And, you know, in anything like Second Life, it's the scaling issues that are the problem. And one aspect of scaling is how big the groups get.
Okay. And you ready for the other one?
Yeah, I do mean groups like that. Sure. What's the other one?
The other one is more a look for some sort of advice or see if you have any ideas. We have one particular individual who keeps joining our Firestorm Support English group. And while I hate to put labels on people, he has been described by multiple people on the team as a pedophile. And it's not just our group.
Okay. Lots of vaults. Okay.
We have banned this
individual.
So it's
presumably someone that is joining using different identities.
Yeah, it's a new account every time. Starman, okay. Whatever. Starman, whatever. And we ban him, but he can still chat. There's a big problem with them still being able to chat, even if you mute them and then ban them. However, that's already something that we've talked about, and you were going to look into that, but he's scouting for young girls in groups and asking for young girls, and we really don't think this is appropriate in G-rated groups, to be honest. Any suggestions on how we deal with somebody who keeps creating new accounts?
I assume that there are ARs on this?
Oh, yes.
Well, drop me an email with whatever hints you have about identity
okay,
or
okay.
Naming patterns, and I'll pass it on. That's really the best I can do.
Okay, thank you. It's just the fact that you can mute him, ban him, and then he still keeps on chatting is really annoying. But the bigger issue,
yeah,
is,
that's a bug, and we'll at some point we'll get around to fixing that.
Yeah, the bigger issue is he's just constantly coming back, and there's nothing we can really
right.
do. Right? He could fill up a ban list on his own. what Worley's saying in local. We'll get you an email with his name and
okay.
A list of the names that we've had so far. So.
All right. I will pass that to the people who worry about such things. Whose job it is to worry about such things, in fact.
Yep, that works, John. Thanks.
Cool. So, any other topics? I know I was late, so I'm perfectly willing to go a little over if we need that to happen.
Can we have more hot weather, please?
I've got a shortage myself at the moment.
Get some of those people down in Florida to send some up the coast to you.
Yeah.
Oh, North has got one. Bug 861.
8616. What do we got here? Oh, bother. Not the internal browser, use the external browser.
I do have one other thing, but it was sort of for Izzy.
Yeah, as far as I know, the all the fixes we know about for the so-called cube trick avatars have been included in the attachments viewer. I'm obviously behind here. What's going on in chat here? Yeah, well, so bug, what's the external number? It's mate 5247 internally, and it's bug 8616 externally. That's still open, so obviously there are some aspects of it we think still need attention.
No, Mr. Polygrip. Polygrip.
Actually, they told us we shouldn't use copyrighted names in the viewer names.
So the only other thing I had on this was I was hoping Izzy would be here. I had a user who has a Linden home whose control panel wasn't working. They contacted live chat and were asked to clear their cache.
I got to get them to stop saying that.
Yeah. I mean, I understand. I totally get the clearing cache thing, okay? I totally get it, but when it's a control panel in a Linden home, the viewer's got nothing to do with it. Nothing.
Right. Yeah, that one's a region restart problem, and I don't know what the deal with that is.
At any rate, I'll consider that I put a bug in your ear, and that's close enough.
I will. We have a once a week huddle with support, and I will make sure I bring it up next time we do that.
Thank you.
We have a once a week get together between the support leads and the engineering and product leads, and we get together and talk about what's coming up and what might cause problems and what sort of problems to be looking for and how frequently have various problems kept happening and all that. So if folks want things brought up about stuff like that, you can email me and I'll mention them. On automatic deflattening inventory fixes. Yes, I believe that it's not automatic. Somebody has to push a button. But I believe that change is deployed. That is to say, if you call support and say, I can't log in because my inventory is too big, please fix it. They can do that. And the next time you log in, it will have modified your inventory structure by. It's a little difficult to define what too big means, and the reason that it's difficult is that the problem is. Is that the way the viewer does the initial fetch of your inventory is that it first fetches everything that's at the root level of your inventory, and then it walks through each of the folders that it got in that first pass and does a fetch of everything in the top level of each of the folders and continues down the tree in that way, right? So So if those fetches are, if one or more of those fetches are really big, if you never have more than 10 items in a folder, each of those fetches is going to be blazingly fast, right? And you'll be able to do lots of them in a row, and it will all just work beautifully. If you have a folder that has 45,800 items in it, that response is going to take much longer. And it's going to take longer both because, you know, bundling it up from the database is going to take longer to encode the messages and the data. And then obviously it's going to take longer to transmit that data because there's more of it. There's also a lot of processing that happens in the viewer as that data comes in. And that's going to take a long time. And while you're doing those things, your viewer is not doing anything else. In particular, it's not keeping up with letting the server know that it's still healthy. And so if you get stuck loading the viewer and it slows down your I'm still here messages that the server relies on, the server will say, oh, I haven't heard from that avatar in too long. I'm logging them out. And there you go. Poof. Right. So, but how bad that problem is a function of both how much data there is and how good your network connection is between you and the ultimately the simulator and the inventory server, and how fast your computer is, because it's that processing each item as it comes in is a big part of the. So if you have a slow connection and a slow system, then you really want to keep your folders much smaller than if you have a very, very fast connection and a very, very fast system. Then you could get away with having bigger folders. I believe that the limit we set in the inventory transform that support can run on request is 10,000. So if you have a folder with more than 10,000 items in it, where an item is either an object or a subfolder, then it will sort the items in the folder by age, and then create subfolders that are named for the name of the first object in it and the date concatenated onto it. And you'll end up with a whole bunch of subfolders that have.
Okay. I have a quick question for you.
The date of the objects in it, not the current date of the transformers run on.
Okay. Will this result in content loss? Because I lost an avatar shape while it was loading. It's now corrupt. I can't use it.
No, I don't. That was pretty carefully tested stuff. What it does is create subfolders and push things down into the subfolders. It creates new folder objects, but other than that, it doesn't either create or delete anything. Why people perceive the frequency of the large number of items in a folder has gone up, I really don't know. Many people have this problem with calling card folders, and I'd like to figure out how we can clean up calling card folders. But
I can see this as being a possible problem for Viewer Managed Marketplace.
Viewer Managed Marketplace have asked residents to limit their number of things in that full part of the inventory hierarchy to 5,000 listings. You can go over that. Whether or not that will cause you a problem is a function of how fast your network and how fast your system are. It won't cause Marketplace a problem. Marketplace doesn't care. I'll get back to your question, Jeeves, in a minute. There's an automatic transform that will happen for people who don't convert their stores by hand. And that transform will prune your marketplace contents down to 5,000 listings. If you don't do it by yourself, then running the transform will prune your listings. And you'll get the objects back. They get put in your, I forget where it is, and I think it's in your received items folder. But they won't be in your marketplace folder. Right. But that's only for people who have more than 5,000 listings, which is not very many. Yeah, the calling card thing is a different thing, and there have been bugs in the past that caused caused calling cards to get duplicated, and if you ended up with that bug biting you a couple of times, we all know what happens when you multiply by two every now and then. Goes up really, really fast. You had a question, G. I don't want to forget that there was one. Go ahead and put it. That is not a question I am authorized to answer.
Okay, I think we got to take a stab at it there.
Yeah. you may have noticed a pattern. Anything that has anything to do with anything legal, I am not allowed to talk about. Period. End of story. So it's not my job.
Okay. Well, I spoke to legal about 5 years ago with a person there, and I won't go for the whole story because I've repeated quite a few times.
You can reach them at legal@lindenlab.com.
Yep, I was on the phone with them 5 years ago. So yeah.
Good luck with that. I'll restrict myself to dealing with software.
Okay. Well, I just say I did have good results 5 years ago, and I'll leave it at that.
The number of as for the purposes of the inventory fetching, a subfolder is the same as any other single object, right? So it's the same as an image or a prim or whatever. It's just how many. So there's an easy explanation, right? Everything in your inventory has a parent ID, and if it's in the root of your inventory, that parent ID is null, and if it's in anything else, the parent ID is the ID of the folder that it's in. Right, so that's how the tree is organized, and so it's the number of things that have the same parent ID that you want to keep under around 10K. Smaller is better. A few thousand is probably not going to hurt anybody. Several hundred is certainly not going to hurt anybody, but we have seen people with as few as 10,000 items who are having trouble getting logged in. They don't get counted as inventory items, but they. We have talked about putting that limit back in. Of course, the transition problem is significant. Yeah, so, I mean, if you're having the timing out problem, you can contact support and ask them to run the transform on you, and then you'll probably not having that anymore. Yeah, sorry, I'm using internal terminology there. But it's an inventory fix that they can run. We call them transforms, and there's a bunch of them.
Okay, Oz, quick question on that. Can that be done while we're still logged in, or do we need to log out while they're doing that?
No, you need to be logged out.
Need to be logged out on that. Okay.
Right. Which, of course, they can ensure is true before they do anything.
Yeah, Whirly just asked a real good question.
I don't know. I assume so. I assume that they will do it for basic people. I don't know. If people are having trouble with that, we can ask somebody to figure it out. It's a relatively new thing. There is always the possibility that the individual human that you end up connected with when you contact support has not learned that it exists or knows how to use it yet. It's only just been added to things. There is some propagation delay there. Yes, it's true that shapes are not validated on upload. Maybe someday we should change that, but it turns out to be kind of tricky to do. Yeah, I would like to add more validation for all kinds of things when they get uploaded. But you know, then you run into the problem of, I was able to upload this last week and this week I can't, and why not, and you know, yada yada yada. People have been getting really old shapes suddenly go missing from the database, though, not just freshly created ones. Well, I don't know. Sort of thing I'd want to have a documented example of to be able to try to track down.
A documented example. I can do that real quick, Oz, because I have a whole slew of cannot find item when I attach a avatar shape on. So I can document that for you.
Test it on the attachments viewer, and if you can repro it there, then file a JIRA.
Yes, sir. Can do that real quick. Matter of fact, we'll do it after the meeting. Yeah, I can't even do that, Whirly. I can't even pass the stupid shape.
iCloud? What is iCloud? Or are you just using that term loosely?
iCloud drives us crazy.
It's cloud service device, us.
Like Google Drive or OneDrive.
Oh.
The old SkyDrive thing.
And people are putting... Yeah, I know what the iCloud thing is, but what's it got to do with Second Life? That's the question.
It interferes with all sorts of stuff. Macs, for example, an upload, if they don't have their file picker set right, they crash.
Oh, yeah, that one bit me last week, and I thought it had been fixed, so I filed a new bug on it, and Whirly corrected me.
Yeah, it's been known to crash the viewers.
Right. There was a bug on the Windows iCloud plugin that was bad for viewers, and I don't even know what the, and it wasn't anything we could do anything about. It was an OS crash.
Yes, see, I'm on Windows, and so far it hasn't been a problem for me. So far, cross my fingers on that one.
Yeah, right. That was part of the TC Mallet problems, right?
There was another one that was a cloud service that caused a whole lot of problems with the viewer crashing.
Yeah, we're not.
SkyDrive did that a long time ago.
Right, SkyDrive was a problem too. Right, and the avatar, or the sorry, the. The Mac file picker problem I demonstrated last week is still a problem. Or it might have been even earlier this week.
Yeah, that's not related to iCloud, though.
No. It's actually an OpenGL context problem in the file picker widget. It messes your it installs a new OpenGL context and then doesn't put it back the way it left it when it exits. It's just sloppy. Yeah, it did. Thank you, Whirly. We've had two or three rounds of attempts to fix that, and so far, still not bulletproof. It's too bad because, of course, when what you're uploading is an image. Using the CoverFlow file picker is the obvious correct thing to use.
Yeah, I've had some issues when trying to upload textures with something with regards to. Hold on just a second. Use lossless compression. I've had problems with that one distorting the images. and distorting them bad.
I suspect that that's a checkbox that causes more problems than it's worth, frankly. People have to think a little bit about what it means to upload an image to Second Life, because that image isn't going to be displayed on your computer. It's going to be displayed on a lot of other people's computers with a huge range of capabilities. Getting too crazy about, I need to have this, you know, bit for bit exactly, look exactly the way I think it should, is not actually very realistic. Okay, you guys seem to have run out of topics. So I think I'll call it.
It's for me. Thanks, Oz. And I'll send you an email, Oz, and pass that on.
Yeah, I'll do something with it.
All right.
Okay, Oz, do you want me to, when I document the deal with the shapes, do you want me to send you an email on that or just file a JIRA on it?
Just file a JIRA. I'll see it in triage.
Okay. I can do that.
All right, great. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, all. We'll catch you all later. And poof.